Just a couple of things, sort of carryover points. If you have been listening this morning, you probably certainly appreciate things like, if you want to pull off VBID at the state level, payer alignment is a big deal, like a really big deal. If you want to be successful in this area, some states have a lot of latitude to operate and try to experiment. So we've heard a little bit about some failures, but a lot of fast winners and capitalizing quickly. It looks like with more than luck, you can achieve big successes in year 01. We've seen some very impressive examples of that. We also understand that it's quite important to be, as Joan told me after we broke up the last session, I said, come on, Joan, like, how's this really working? And Joan said, well, somebody's got to be really pushy. She didn't say who that was in Oregon, but I kind of guessed who it might have been. But what we have seen, and we also saw this at the state's discussion early on, the first thing off this morning, was that building kind of these long-term trust relationships with state legislatures, with financial people, with boards and so forth. It's not that they have to understand all the science and all the policy and economics, but if you show them that you've got something that'll work and have an impact, they tend to trust you more. It gives you a little bit more working room. And so that's been, I know, to me, a huge lesson. Another couple of huge lessons include understanding microeconomics. I will not forget this thing about the difference between being told that you're going to take 100 bucks away from me or you're going to give me 100 bucks, which one works better. So for any student here that's kind of complaining about taking microecon, there's something in there for you. Also, we saw a great contrast between Oregon just now and Connecticut insofar as kind of how far we're casting our VBID program. So Joan in Oregon gave us that long list of procedures. Remember, she said spine surgery, sleep studies, upper endoscopies, visco supplementation, and others. And she's in Oregon, they ventured that far. Connecticut hasn't done that yet, but they're thinking about trying it. So once again, in what the VBID program has assembled here for us today is basically report backs from a pretty diverse laboratory of real-time on-the-ground experiments for trying to see what works. And this fast feedback loop is really paying off, I think. So speaking of that and what we can learn quickly at state levels, our next session is adding clinical nuance to Medicaid. We've got somebody who's kind of one of the recognized sort of leading-edge consultants in this field who does a lot of work with state governments. We've got a state director, a Michigan Medicaid director here, and we've also got somebody who works in San Diego at a more municipal level in the context of what's going on in municipal level, counties, and state levels. We're going to learn quite a bit about that. Each of them is going to show anywhere from 1 to 7 or 8 slides. We've got time for panel discussion and Q&A following. So Seema Verma, who is the founder of SBC, is going to start off by telling you what SBC is and why she founded it, if she doesn't mind, and then she'll proceed. Seema, you're on.
So that's.
But you're flexible. You know, you've done this before. I know.
So I've been in consulting probably about 12 years, but over the last few years, in my consulting role, started the Healthy Indiana Plan.
She is on. Yeah. If you're wearing a tie, I would help her adjust it.
Yeah, sorry. Is that better? No. Is this better? We'll just do that.
Put your pen down. No. Okay, good. Thanks.
Okay.
That's awkward.
It is a little awkward. Okay, well, just a little bit about myself and the consulting business. Been doing this for about 12 years, and in that role worked with the Daniels administration in developing their Healthy Indiana Plan, which was the nation's first consumer-directed health plan. So in that role, been working with some other states as well around consumer-directed health programs and also helping states around the Affordable Care Act and implementation. So SVC's grown and one of our primary areas happens to be in this consumer-directed area. Great. So I'll start and tell you a little bit about the Healthy Indiana Plan, but before that, maybe just kind of a little bit of level setting. I think we've heard a lot today about payment reform. We've heard about providers working with individuals, and even the last sessions, I think, were really important where we're talking about state employees. And in Indiana's history, that's exactly where they started. They had done a lot of changes around consumer-directed health care with their state employee plan. And then they started to talk about the Medicaid program. So this is in 2007, where they were talking about what should we do around the uninsured. We got through our entire process never talking about it in the words of, we never used the words Medicaid. It was always just the Healthy Indiana Plan or a program for the uninsured. But the concept here, and I like to tell this story because I think it sort of captures it. I have a neighbor who had a son who he's broke his arm, and they went to the med check, and they did the x-ray, and they said, yeah, the arm is broken. She calls her friend, the orthopedic surgeon, and he says, well, you know, we're not going to be able to cast that. You just need to stay home. The swelling needs to go down, and then we'll put a cast on it on Monday. This is Friday. But the urgent visit center insisted that she go to the hospital. So she goes to the hospital, sits in the waiting room for 2 or 3 hours. They come out, and they say, yeah, we can't do anything for you. You've got to wait, go back on Monday, see the orthopedic guy. And so she never even went into an examining room. They may have given her son some pain medication. She never gave them her insurance card because she wasn't admitted and no one really saw her. So at the end of the day, she gets a bill for $1,200. And she said, I'm going to fight this because this doesn't make any sense. Nobody saw me. I was told to come here. But I think the concept here is that because she got the bill, because she saw it, because she realized that it wasn't appropriate, that she was able to take some action. And that we understand here, and I think when we looked at the Healthy Indiana Plan, as we said, that experience of patients being involved consumers, making decisions about where they go for their health care, what kind of dollars are going to be spent, that they have a very important role to play in that equation. It's not just about capitating the health insurers or putting risk onto providers, but that the individual has a huge role to play in that. And we didn't think in Indiana that poor people couldn't be a part of that as well, that they certainly had the ability to be consumers of health care. And just because you're poor doesn't mean that you can't make cost and quality decisions. In fact, they're making those types of decisions every day. So that was the concept behind the Healthy Indiana Plan. For the most part, it is a regular managed care plan. But what makes a Healthy Indiana Plan different, and they put the slide up. But the idea is that it's a health insurance plan with an $1,100 deductible. Governor Daniels really liked the concept of an HSA and wanted to have that for the Medicaid recipients. And we looked at this, and even I said, well, how are we going to deal with that? That's an $1,100 deductible. Poor individuals aren't going to be able to pay for that. We looked at all the research about why HSA plans and high deductible health plans don't work. And we said, okay, we're going to address those issues. And so we came up with the HIP plan. And the way it works is that individuals have an account that they contribute money into. So they are contributing between 2 to 5% of their income. And those are required contributions. They have to make it. It has to happen within 60 days. They're supposed to make it every month, but there's a grace period. So it may take them up to 60 days to make that contribution. If they do not make the contribution, they're out of the program, and they're out of the program for 12 months. And we'll come back and talk about how that's playing on the national level. And then the state actually puts some money into the account as well to get it to that $1,100 level, because the idea here is that we want people to feel like they're managing this account. And if the account wasn't fully funded, then that would create some problems for them on the front end. Preventative services are not a part of the account as well, so they get that in terms of first dollar coverage. And then after that, there is no cost sharing except for co-pays for non-emergency room of the ER. And the reason for this was the state talked about co-pays. Could we use that as a mechanism? But there was a lot of concern that providers don't collect co-pays, and that really any type of a co-pay sometimes amounted to being a provider cut. Because the provider doesn't collect it, but then their payment is reduced by that copay amount. So it was really an effort to sort of restructure how we do cost sharing with individuals by making this sort of an upfront amount. The eligibility goes up to 200% of the federal poverty level, although the program has changed, and with the Affordable Care Act, it'll just cover people up to 100% of the poverty level and people that don't have access to employer-sponsored health insurance. I think the idea here, as we look at this plan, this is starting to be examined in other states. I know Idaho and Iowa have looked at that, and there are some components of their plans that they're considering as well that have pieces of the HIP plan. The idea here is to have individuals making some type of a contribution so that they have skin in the game. It's not about paying for the program on the backs of poor people. I mean, obviously the amounts of money that we're talking about are small, but the idea is that if people don't have skin in the game, then they have nothing vested there. If they're making a contribution, it's their money that they're spending. And the way our account works is that this money, they can, you know, they've got that $1,100, they pay for the first, for their deductible expenses. And then at the end of the year, if there's any money in that account, the money rolls over if that person has done their preventative services. If they haven't, then only their portion of what's left rolls over. So they lose the state's contribution, and that actually reduces what they owe in the following year. So some of the results that we've seen, we do have a small group of people that don't pay because of their income and the way CMS counts income. So we have a small percentage of about 23% of people that don't make contributions, which has given us a great comparison group. And we've seen the data shows us that the people that are making contributions have lower ER use. They're using their primary care doctors more. They use more generic drugs. And so even those small amounts of cost sharing seem to make a big difference in how people are looking at their healthcare services and how they utilize care. I think the issue now for Indiana is that this was a waiver that was submitted. It started in 2008. It was originally a five-year waiver. And as soon as the Affordable Care Act passed, the state said, well, if we're going to think about an expansion, and this is before the Supreme Court, they said, well, we'll only do an expansion if it's going to be the HIP plan. After the Supreme Court, when it actually became optional, then that question became more, can we do this? Will you consider this, CMS? And so I think the issue now becomes this group below 100% of poverty, and nationally, and whether CMS will go in the direction of allowing the states to charge people that are below 100% of the poverty level. The difficult part for Indiana is that they look at the data, and like I said, that group of people that don't pay or have zero contributions, they're usually below 22% of the poverty level. But they have a fair amount of people that are about 23-30% of the poverty level to 100% of the poverty level that are making contributions. And to get rid of those contributions, since that's sort of the linchpin of the program, sort of makes the whole thing collapse. So I think at this point they are, you know, continuing negotiations and figuring out, you know, is there a way to restructure the HIP plan, you know, maybe create an alternative plan or looking at some different models to figure out how to continue this, but also try to address CMS's needs. We do have people that fall out of the program because they don't or they can't pay. And that's certainly an issue. I think arguably, though, there would be that segment of the population regardless in any type of program. But I think nationally that's where it stands right now, is that cost sharing and trying to create some type of incentive program in a lot of the concepts that we've talked about today is very difficult for people below 100% of poverty unless there's some type of change on the federal level to allow more flexibility for states.
Thank you, Sue. Great point. And I'm just reminded again that understanding the kind of the nuances of cost sharing, small amounts, especially as the response changes according to where you are in poverty level, that kind of in-depth understanding can make a big difference insofar as kind of the uptake of these programs. So, point very well made. Thank you very much, Seema, and the other points as well. Steve Fitton's up next. He's the director of Michigan's Medicaid program. He's been so for 4 years, but if you checked out his bio, you might notice that he's been part of health policy making in this state for 10 times that long. So whenever people talk about, you know, government workers and state government workers as not being fully there for us or not just putting in their 9-to-5s, this is not the guy they're talking about here. So he made a career-long commitment to health and welfare in the state, and so what better person to kind of talk about how things are changing at the Medicaid program? Steve.
Thank you. And I fully own up to being a career bureaucrat, so yeah. Wear that proudly. Maybe just a couple preliminary remarks. Number one, you can see how clever we were in naming our program for the what we don't say, which is the Medicaid expansion. So this is Healthy Michigan. We do steal, you know, steal shamelessly from each other, and we've obviously stolen from Indiana here. Fortunately, we didn't steal from Ohio, and they're still working on their legislation, so that's better. And I see John McCarthy bailed on us, so I will harass him endlessly the next time I see him. But anyway, but this actually has dominated not only my life, but many individuals in state government, the governor's office, and so forth, trying to get this legislation passed. We've been working on since roughly March. And it has been sort of the singular focus. So the nice part of this is actually the only topic I am currently able to speak about with any degree of knowledge, because I've pretty much forgotten everything else we were doing. But I do want to say that the governor, I mean, really believes in this program in the context that it is a genuine effort to make the population, especially the low-income population of Michigan, healthier. And so that is really the impetus, and that's what's behind this, and we've incorporated VBID principles, which actually syncs up well, since, again, this is the only thing I'm really able to talk about with any degree of knowledge at this point. So fortunately, it syncs in with the theme of this conference. So now I don't think I know which button to push.
Probably one on the right.
Let's try that one. Aha, it worked. Okay, and we're doing things in a hurry, so I think you're going to see there's a mistake here, because there are two of these boxes that say the same thing by mistake. But I don't know how many of you have been involved with legislation, and I haven't had really a lot of involvement historically, but I've had a lot of involvement this time around, and when people describe it like making sausage, I think that's a fair description. And, you know, it really wasn't enough, and clearly was not enough to just say we're going to cover more childless adults and more parents under the Medicaid program because of this opportunity that's available under the Affordable Care Act, that, you know, we need to do something different for Medicaid. And this is in spite of the fact that we can make a very strong case that the Michigan Medicaid program is well-run, is cost-effective, that the individuals who are served get access to services. We've got metrics. We have 7 of the top 25 health plans in the nation on the Medicaid side of the board, so we have high-quality health plans, and we have all the evidence that children and adults, including the disabled, are getting to their doctors, and they're being served appropriately. But there was, you know, an incredible need to think about how do you change the Medicaid program, and I think probably dual motives. One is just to make it different from the standard Medicaid program because of the politics, and I hope you don't repeat that too widely. But, I mean, the other is, you know, motivation, I think, was a genuine effort to try to think about how can we improve the program and how can we put incentives in place that lead to, you know, to a more effective system and to better behavioral choices on the part of individuals so they're healthier. So anyway, what you can see here is in the upper left, it just says cover childless adults and more parents, which would be sort of the basic element of an expansion. But then there are numerous reforms, if you will, to the Medicaid program, looking at many different aspects of the program, but with special emphasis on skin in the game on the part of beneficiaries in terms of these health savings like accounts, HSA-like accounts, and I say the emphasis is on likes because they really aren't traditional HSAs as in the private sector. But a lot of attention there, and with VBID principles in terms of co-pays and healthy behaviors, and then just a lot of emphasis on the incentives in the system for health plans and for providers as well as individuals. So, but we pretty much, as you work through the process, and we only got this through the Senate on a 20-18 vote, so every idea any senator had was a good idea, at least among the Republicans. And so, you know, we incorporated a lot of components to the legislation, and I'm not critiquing any of them. It's just that there were a series of ideas that kind of went along the process, and that's how the process works. And so this is what we have. We are doing a rather significant waiver in order to put this plan in place, and I think it was important that we distinguish this from the standard Medicaid program that you can run under traditional regulation. And so what's kind of featured here in terms of what the big issues would be that the federal government would need to grant a waiver is that we're assessing the population between 100 and 133% of poverty, a 2%, what I would call a premium. We call it a required contribution, but in any case, there's a cost to the individuals above 100% of poverty. And the reason we aren't below 100% of poverty is that would be a deal killer with the federal government, but their standard historically has been 150% of poverty. So we're breaking new ground in this 100 to 133% category. And obviously an HSA-like account is different than what the standard Medicaid program would be as well. And so those two elements are really, I mean, there are other aspects of this that we need to get approved. Some of them are through traditional state plan amendments and so forth. But those are really the elements that set this apart from what a Medicaid program would be under a more traditional regulatory structure. Sooner or later, this will move. Okay. Well, as Seema was talking about, skin in the game was a phrase that was repeated over and over and over. And as I said, we're requiring these contributions for the individuals above 100%, and we're requiring copays for those both above and below 100% of poverty. And we have these HSA-like accounts, even though the government will be fully funding them, other than the copay piece for those under 100% of poverty. But, you know, so the notion is that if you, you know, familiarize the beneficiaries with the cost of care and get them involved in terms of their contribution, you know, will that achieve the end of engagement to actually get them to change how they use the system and how they take care of themselves, and will they indeed be healthier as a result? What motivates folks? And I think one of the big questions, because employers have obviously, and commercial insurers have been at this a lot longer and have a lot more money to play with. I mean, they can make an ER visit a $100 copay if it's non-urgent, and there's a lot more money that you can put in play in a commercial environment with a higher income population. But for a Medicaid population, can you make these principles work? And is there enough money involved in terms of what the cost is? Because copays are supposed to be nominal. So typically in the Medicaid program, an office visit copay maximum was 2%, and that was only applicable to adults, or $2. So is $2 enough to influence somebody in terms of whether they go to the doctor? And because you couldn't refuse to see the person, you know, then the person didn't really necessarily have to pay, and it was complicated to discharge them as a patient. So, you know, there really been questions about, is Medicaid program the type of program that these types of incentives can be effective? And then there's the whole sort of behavioral economics question of what incentives really work and how are they structured, and, you know, can you make them work effectively? And so I think, you know, really, in a lot of ways, we are now confronting this issue in Michigan with this program. So, you know, can we make this work? How will it work? You know, how effective will it be with the beneficiaries and the population that we're going to be engaging with, which is a new population to Medicaid. It's childless adults who, no matter how poor they were, couldn't be on Medicaid because of the historic categorical nature of eligibility for Medicaid. So, this is a VBID conference, so want to make sure we cover the VBID principles, but they are very significant, and certainly linking contributions to healthy behaviors and being able to reduce this premium of 2% with healthy behaviors is really a core element of the program as we have it designed. And so one of the key questions, maybe a research question, I'm sure folks are going to be studying this, is, you know, to what extent will this be effective? And we're in the process of structuring what this healthy behaviors piece will look like, and we're thinking it's an interaction between the primary care physician and the beneficiary, and the beneficiary would agree to do certain things, and if they do, then they can get their premium waived. Well, is the 2% waiver enough to really move people? And, you know, maybe to get somebody to quit smoking isn't the same as to get them to, you know, take a walk every day. I mean, so there, I think there's different levels of effort on the part of the beneficiary population depending on the type of behavior you're trying to modify, which would suggest that you probably need differential types of incentives. I mean, maybe we should pay somebody $500 if they quit smoking in addition to waiving their premium, but then maybe they wouldn't be eligible for Medicaid anymore because it's income. So, I mean, and that is one of the quandaries you get caught up in the Medicaid program because of its structure. There are actually, and I don't know if this is a credit to Mark or where it is, but there are really three sections of the legislation that essentially say the same thing, which are the core VBID principles, and that is, we have the ability to differentiate copays and waive copays for specific services that are higher value and that prevent the progression of disease. So we're now able, and before we had kind of a blunt instrument copay structure based on the legislation, so now we can, you know, be more nuanced and differentiate copays and zero them out for the services that we think are high value. And like I said, it repeats it three times, so, you know, we're bureaucrats, but I think we got the idea here. They've convinced us. So I think another important VBID principle, as I've learned them, is alignment, so that you want alignment on the part of providers and beneficiaries so that the motivations are in sync, and that, therefore, both the provider and the beneficiary are motivated in the same direction. And I think in our case, because we're pretty much a full managed care state and have the vast majority of our beneficiaries in managed care plans, that we want the managed care plans to be equally incented in the right direction. So part of this legislation, and I think this is very smart, is to get the health plans, the providers, and the enrollees all on the same page and have the financial incentives pushing in the same direction. Now, I'm not sure how we're doing time-wise, but McCarthy didn't show up. So I'm going to tell a story. And it has to do with when I first got the policy job in Medicaid. So this was I was a bureau level. This is the job before this one, and it was about 10 years ago. And I was pretty much brand new and starting to interact with different folks on the outside. And, you know, this emergency room problem just kept coming up. You know, all these people are going to the emergency room for non-urgent visits, and it's a real problem, and, you know, it's terrible. You know, somebody should do something about it. And I thought, well, you know, we have all these resources. We have these universities like the University of Michigan, Michigan State. So we have health researchers and health policy people there that are really smart and know what's going on. Get the medical society, and the ED docs have their society as a specialty society, and we'll get the hospitals, and we'll just get everybody at the table, and we'll figure this out. I mean, how hard can this be? So we convene these meetings, and we got all the players there, and the university folks go off, and they look at the research, and they come back and say, well, this is harder than you might think. There are interventions that have occurred that can move the needle a bit, but it doesn't look like it's sustainable, and it seems to bounce back, and it's true on the commercial side, let alone the Medicaid side, and, you know, pretty challenging. But nevertheless, we want to push on. Well, as we pushed on and dug into this, what we found out is, because Medicaid right now covers 40% of the children in the state are on Medicaid. So Medicaid is really about children, the disabled, and the aged, and a few really, really poor parents thrown in. And so the children are a really big deal and a big part of this issue. And so what do we find out? Well, the ED copay is like $3 or $4. But even if it was $10, or even if it was more, there are significant requirements on these parents. Number one is if they don't go to work, they don't get paid. So if they're in a very low-paying job and their child's on Medicaid, they're going to get docked to pay, and that's going to cost them significant money. So they're really much better off going to work during the day and taking their child, and if the primary care doc or whoever it is isn't open in the evening, they go to the ED. It's a rational choice on their part. And it's even true of those who are on income assistance because they had these work or education requirements, and they would get hammered there, and the hammering would be worse than if they just went to the ED and paid this copay. So that didn't work well. Well, the providers aren't particularly interested in being open after hours, you know, so they aren't exactly helping with this problem. And then we find out the hospitals really, frankly, at that point, I think, had mixed motives. They were concerned about the loss of revenue because the ED is a profit center for them and, you know, a place where they're getting income and revenue from the program. And they, you know, they kind of played nice, but I thought they lacked enthusiasm. And I don't know who's here from the hospital industry, but... Anyway, so, you know, you talk about alignment and you talk about a problem. Well, here's a problem where basically the health plan would be motivated to achieve this because they would reduce their expenditures. But there wasn't any, really, the incentives were totally ineffective, both for the providers and for the enrollees. And the providers, I mean, you have to pay, obviously, with patient-centered medical homes, I think we're making some progress and some financial incentives to keep the doors open after 5. But the reality of this was really sobering, and I think, you know, in the end, it was like, you know, it is what it is, and to some extent, you know, we moved on. I kind of gave up on this, frankly, and you know, I think it's worth hacking away at, and the patient-centered medical home is helpful as a concept. But anyway, so I'm going to go through the last 2 slides quickly because, frankly, they're not that important. But there is a lot of emphasis on skin in the game. There are pieces of this legislation that are really pointed to, you know, you really got to get this money from the beneficiaries, and so we're even going to incent the health plans to collect this amount because we don't want to put it on the providers. And anyway, so there's a big push there. And then, like, the last slide is just me complaining. But
you need more slides for that?
Well, you know, to read it. Yeah. But I think the point is there are actually 16 sort of initiatives, if you will, or studies that we're supposed to do where we're supposed to issue reports ultimately. And so it's always interesting as a person who has confessed a state bureaucrat, you know, and we're always being jammed, why do you need so many staff? Why do you need this? Why do you need that? Well, every time they added a report, I would say to these legislators, you just increase, you know, our administrative budget because I got to hire somebody to do this stuff. But there are numerous, I mean, part of this is to say, that this was attacked in a way that we want to look at every aspect of the Medicaid program. We want to think about important issues, and these are all important issues. And so I think that's legitimate and interesting. But this legislation is chock full of all kinds of stuff that we need to look at and try to figure out. And in some ways, really is an lift for us in terms of administrative push. And I think I'll just leave it at that because I'm not sure it's worth getting into all the details here. So I'm going to stop there.
Okay. Thank you very much, Steve. When Steve was talking about, when he gave his anecdote about the ER problem and the trade-off that some parents experience with regard to providing access to their kid and then making it to the job at the same time, Nick Moscione was nodding his head. I noticed that. And the reason he was nodding his head is that he knows something about that. Again, if you read his bio, it says, of course, that he's the director of Health and Human Services, Health and Human Services Agency, County of San Diego. So he's got municipal county responsibilities, but he oversees the largest integrated health and human services network at the local level. And I emphasize integrated and, because one of the things that Nick's going to emphasize here is the bigger picture and how you manage that at a municipal and county level. So Nick, you're on.
Thank you. Is this on?
Yes. It is.
Thanks, Cliff. When Mark, and I appreciate the invitation, asked me to talk about VBID in the context of population health, it was very intriguing, in part because we had a meeting a year prior in Whitefish, Montana, that led me really thinking deep and wide as to how are we using the principles of VBID in furthering population-based health. And the other reason I guess I was invited is we've talked quite a bit about the state-federal relationship, that love-hate relationship we'll call federalism. But what do we call the relationship between counties and states? There has to have a new name for that. So I'm going to give you the retail experience. I'm going to give you the experience, at least in Southern California, of how we are navigating through both things like the Affordable Care Act from federal pressures, but also managing with our counterparts up at the state. In California alone, to give you a perspective, San Diego is about 3.2 million residents. My agency alone is about $2 billion annually. And we have 400,000 Medicaid lives. Because of the sheer size, we have a state Medicaid director, but my relationship with that state Medicaid director is really focusing more on the quality assurance at the San Diego County level. So it provides a unique nuance of being not the negotiator on terms of contracts, but a partner and a convener to talking about service delivery. And so I'm going to talk about how we're all embarking, municipalities, localities, on driving population-based health. And I think for us, whether you see this as a challenge or a crisis, with all the downward pressures, be it with chronic disease, be it with the implementation of the Affordable Care Act, and for California, that's a big deal for us in our benefit exchange, be it also with the looming penalties for inpatient care facilities on avoidable hospital readmissions, and something we did not talk about, the new IRS guidelines on community benefit for healthcare institutions, and how they need to reinvest into the community around population-based health in part. So lots of opportunities for us that we see, and San Diego's version of that is a full-fledged 10-year plan approved by our electeds in 2010 that commits $5 billion a year. Now, I just mentioned I had $2 billion of health and human services. What's the other three? Public safety, parks and recreation, libraries, roads. So we've taken a health and all policies approach. And it's a significant gamble because $50 billion over 10 years better yield some good outcomes. But we're very confident because the way we're tackling this issue, and you'll see the nexus in VBID in a sec, is that we're talking primarily today about health. But in many of our communities, in the presence of violence, you can't achieve anything on health. So we've had to bring in law enforcement to be in sometimes painful conversations about population health. But we've been blessed in part because we've been helping the jails access Medicaid dollars to help them save general purpose revenue, to be part of the equation of creating these kind of safe communities so we can get people to go to their primary care doctor and clinic. So the whole nexus, and I think it was talked several times by panel and the prior panels, that it's also about housing and shelter and food. So as Cliff said, as an integrated health and human service agency, we're dealing with child protection to senior food nutrition to Medicaid enrollment and running primary care clinics and everything in between. And to begin to see how all these streams have to fit in, driving towards improving longevity and quality of life, is really the aim of our population-based strategy. So I want to drill it down, though, for our conversation, mainly around two areas. One is the what we call Medi-Medis. Those are Medicare and Medicaid. And I think, you know, I think hopefully everyone knows, it's a staggering number when you think in 2008 we had about 9 million of the beneficiaries that were concurrently enrolled both in Medicare and Medicaid. About 20% were in Medicare, 15% were in Medicaid. But here's the kicker. Those dual eligibles accounted for 33% of the total Medicare expenditures and almost 40% of the total Medicaid expenditures. And we heard the frustration from our opening plenary kind of panel about kind of working and nuances with Medicare and the hands-off. But we've been given the opportunity in California with CMS to explore on doing some innovations, care redesigns on this Medi-Medi duals population. And the interest real here came from our hospital partners. And I kind of laughed earlier about the perverse incentives about emergency room use, and I think that was spot on. But the game's changed. As I've said to the hospital CEOs a few years ago, find your area agency on aging director, public health director, social service director, hug them to your next best friend. And first of all, they didn't know where to find them. They never really worked with them. They didn't quite understand it. Today, they're hugging them really tight because it is working immensely in their favor on dealing with the continuity of care from hospital discharge, avoiding the readmission, and the penalties that start in January. And for us, this is the landscape, by the way, that all of our communities live in. So it was no surprise when we started talking about different, and we started hit on different components of this. But you have to look at the entire ecological framework when you talk about care redesign. And this is where the value-based insurance design came into play for us. Because it went well beyond just the dual eligible or just Medicaid design. It was really begging the question of what is the quality value of all these other services and how do they play together? And because as the director of these many of these services, I was able to bring them together to begin to look at how these pieces fit. And to put in the context of a real story, Donald Ryan's a 78-year-old San Diegan. Who's on Medicare and Medicaid, congestive heart failure, diabetes, and he's open about this. And Don's only wish, when we worked with him about 3 years ago now, was to sleep more in his own bed than a hospital bed. Don was a patient of Sharp Memorial Hospital, which is a Baldrige Award-winning hospital. And Don was experiencing some problems. One out of four times he was being readmitted for the same thing, about 25% rate for his congestive heart failure. And this was a great hospital institution. But what they were not doing was really looking at what goes beyond hospital discharge in the home. What they were not looking at is all the clinical nuances of adding more value to stabilizing Don in his home. So we embarked on a pilot. Actually, funds from my agency and with Sharp to look at 88 patients of Donald Ryan's kind of categories to see if we were able to redesign and treat the cause and not the illness, could we make a difference? And meaning not just kind of shuffle the deck, but really begin to change the competencies of your area agency on aging, which has social workers and nurses that work in the community, and train them in becoming more of these transition coaches, still nurses, social workers, but actually working with Don in his home. And we are a beacon community, a health information exchange community. So we're able to use the information from hospital to nurse and field to work with Don. And then here's a kicker, to get his caregivers, families, members, also be part and tied into his care using technology. In the course of doing that, and then, of course, working with some incentives for Don, and the incentives for Don was being able to communicate with his doctor. I'll talk about some of the e-consults that we built in as a result of it. But merely just putting together the value chain and changing this design, in a matter of 1 year, we reduced hospital readmissions for these 88 patients from about 25% to about 8%. The net was $560,000 in Medicare, Medicaid for 88 patients. This was the impetus that got us the award for out of the CMMI for the CCTP, the Community Care Transition Program, this past January, for 21,000 Medicare fee-for-service clients. We're doing that across 13 hospital systems with Health and Human Services as the lead on that. And my criteria on this was not just avoiding the readmission, obviously that would be in the driver, but really looking at how do we add value to the life of Donald Ryan, and how do we begin to create this kind of continuum of care that's going to be sustained. And what's exciting from that is that we then took the principles here and we looked to our Medicaid population. There's a segment of our Medicaid population that we are doing separately between with the local county and the Fed. It's the 1115 Medicaid waiver. We put up $100 million to bring down $100 million from the Fed. And what we did in this population was institute much of what's been heard about the patient-centered medical home, but we added a couple of nuances. One nuance for us was, and the big one here, beyond the pay-for-performance and integration of mental health that Dr. Hazel mentioned, which was big, but the e-consult. And we had a fight pretty hard initially with our state Medicaid office, who had kind of blessed our waiver, because we felt that this was going to help us deal with the shortages and the waits we were having from primary care for specialty visits. Now, that's getting even more compounded as a problem, because the other issue is that we'll hopefully get in the question and answer is, how do we deal now with all these covered lives? So everything has been about coverage of payment reform, but what about service adequacy and quality service adequacy? So for us, it was trying to also deal with getting these primary care physicians to do an e-consult and pay for that with specialists. What that did for us, in the matter of just literally 6 quarters, within 2 years, we significantly drove up our HEDIS measures on 3 key things we were looking at: blood sugar, cholesterol, blood pressure. And what was very astonishing to us was adding some of these incentives on our own. We were, in essence, kind of this mini pilot, because this was only about 40,000 lives. We were showing kind of this pilot for the 400,000 lives in our commercial plans and our Medicaid managed care plans to mimic. Because we're going to now be out of the business, believe it or not, come January, because all these lives are going into our Medicaid managed care programs. And we won't have this subset kind of program we call low-income health program. So we've had to rush to demonstrate the return on investment and the clinical nuances of adding value in hopes that the commercial plans. The good news is several of the plans have already adopted these best practices, which is exciting to us, and they're embracing them. So e-consult was something that we stumbled across and used, again, in the earlier model for the Medi-Medis that then we applied for our Medicaid population that worked well. But what was interesting is that it wasn't until we stood up the money, because CMS wasn't supporting us in doing this e-consult with the state. They are now, but it wasn't initially. So I want to just kind of last slide here is technology. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention, for us, it was building the platform on the Health Information Exchange. We were one of the 17 Beacon communities, and Aaron McKeithen was here, and he was one of the original Beacon directors. But we've taken it further. We know that we need value-based information design, and that's through our IT systems. And so we've actually worked with the local foundation to use the MIDA standards and mimic them for, if you're familiar with the nomenclature, the NEEM standards, permissive language now to have be interoperable with human services data. So we are created now what's called a community information exchange. 100 different nonprofit social service agencies that are part of the care coordination. And I was explaining to Cliff earlier is that if all you have is the interoperability of health, public health and hospitals and clinics, you only have it as it's a unicycle. We were actually talking about how do we bring in these social services, incentivize their participation, but develop the information exchange and then use us as the government, create what's called KIP, our knowledge integration program, to actually create the hubs and connectivity so we can share across these systems. We've invested heavily in this information system because we think that that's going to be really our way of serving, in my agency, 750,000 people across all our programs. But more broadly, for our hospital systems, this was something that they've insisted that they needed, access to the information and the referrals. So that's a little bit of the population-based, and I'll just say that it's not just San Diego. North of us, some counties are doing this, but great work here in Michigan, Indiana, even Austin, Texas. There's a lot of great work happening around population-based, and the question is, how does VBID fit into that equation in driving population health? And that's something I think that's getting traction.
Great. Thanks very much, Nick. Nick, can you flip? This is a great slide, Chamber of Commerce of San Diego. Can you flip back to the cartoon slide with all the stuff on the medical side and the social services side? Yes, okay. So this is what sort of knocks me out about what you just said, and I think it mirrors very well. Well, it is mirrored by our other two speakers who have had to try to figure out how to make this happen. It mirrors our opening panel's discussion when we heard from Arkansas, South Carolina, and Virginia about how complex this is, the problem of breaking down silos at the state level. You've done it at the county level. And what I'm recalling now is what Tony Keck said. He said, we don't even know who our patients are. So all three of these speakers are trying to get at, well, who are our patients after all, and what do we need? So Nick, when you flash this thing, I'm thinking, we're in 2 years going to be hitting the 50th anniversary of the Medicare program, right? 1965, as I recall, LBJ. And he signed the Medicaid bill not long after that. Was anybody thinking about all the stuff up here at that time? Medicare Part A was modeled after Blue Cross, Medicare Part B after Blue Shield. And then when you talk about you call them the Medi-Medis, or some folks call them the duals, who was thinking then that people that were dual eligible for both of those programs were going to account for such a disproportionately large share of expenditures, really coming close to bankrupting some states, frankly, especially on the Medicaid side? Who was thinking about all this stuff? So now in this conference today, what we're faced with is we're taking this concept of VBID, which started out as, well, give some services away free, some screening services and a few drugs, and there'll be a payoff there. Now we're thinking about this, Nick, as you point out, at the population level. How might we apply some VBID principles to embrace all of these things? Because, like Tony said, we don't know who our patients are, and our patients are the people that have to live with all this stuff, and all these are predictors of health status and health outcomes. This is an extraordinary challenge.
You know, in California, one of the things we've added in terms of our benefit exchange is that when you are calling in now, and Medicaid we call it Medi-Cal, is considered just another product. So we treat it as another product. So whether you come in for on the subsidized plan or Medi-Cal. We also ask now if you need food assistance. So we are processing applications for food assistance. That's called the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. It's the first time I've seen that Medicaid and SNAP have been put together,
right, and
the connection on food. This is a program we have in all of our states. We run SNAP programs, yet not even thinking of how are we promoting SNAP education so that we're not creating a bunch of problems down the stream on childhood obesity and other things that then hit us on the Medicaid side.
Right.
They're all tied together.
So, Steve, how you know the state of Michigan better than probably anybody in the state of Michigan at this point, state and the policy side, the health side, and financial side. Can you, at the state level, get your arms around all this stuff at once if you're really trying to improve health outcomes for Michiganders?
Well, number one, your comment is too kind. But, you know, I think it's incredibly challenging, and I'd be inclined. My knee-jerk reaction would be to say no. But that's, you know...
You can leave that up there.
That's not a sufficient answer. I think that there is recognition that there are social determinants of health, and there are a lot of programs that are funded at the state and federal level, let alone at the county level, and, you know, there are a lot of layers to government to bring together that, you know, could work in tandem better. But, you know, there are real challenges in terms of how do you deploy resources to bring these programs together in a way that makes sense. I mean, we have struggle on the eligibility side, just having Medicaid and SNAP. I mean, it's all administered through the Department of Human Services. These are county-level offices, but essentially state employees in a state system. But just to get... So we're making people eligible for SNAP at the same time we're making them eligible for Medicaid for the most part, but there are some differences that are significant enough that there are some real dysfunction there. And so one of the parts of the new legislation, the Healthy Michigan legislation, is to take another look at eligibility. And do we actually want to de-link? Because Medicaid was de-linked from welfare in 1996 or 7. And so the rules are different. The populations are different. SNAP in particular, there's a lot more crossover and commonality. So, you know, I think those populations are much more in sync. But then there are a lot of other programs say, well, if you're going to integrate eligibility, integrate for all these different programs. And it's a real challenge, let alone to get down to what Nick's doing in San Diego, which I think is incredible, to try to then link all of these different organizations that are providing different services that do support each other and are, you know, helpful to each other, to get them to work together in some way. I mean, that's an incredible challenge, and I think that's where we need to get, but I think it's really hard to get
but
there.
But it seems like there's a payoff there. If you can manage some of this stuff better, there are real savings to be had and improvements in health outcomes. And I'm wondering, and, you know, Seema, you're a consultant. You advise people at high levels. Can states duplicate at that level what Nick's starting to pull off in San Diego County insofar as this broader integration? Is it practical to expect that?
I think, you know, as I look at this and you look at the concepts of VBID, which is around, you know, incentives, I don't think that we have the right incentives right now, even at the client level. I mean, I look at the Healthy Indiana plan, and it's around preventative care. If you do your preventative, we give you an incentive, or if you don't visit the emergency room. But I think when you start to look at these supportive services, if we're really talking about outcomes, incenting somebody to go get their cholesterol checked, really at the end of the day, may not have as big of an impact. And I think we have to almost take a step back and really think about all the other social determinants and where we're putting our emphasis, because you're not going to, you know, at the end of the day, and I'm not trying to minimize the importance of preventative health care. I mean, that's certainly an important concept there, but it can't be the only thing, right? It can't be, you know, just chronic disease management. I mean, if you look at the state of Pennsylvania and their talking about doing a Medicaid expansion, although they don't like to call it that either. But they're talking about incentives that are related to job training, that, you know, it's not just around getting preventative care, but that, you know, if you participate or if you, you know, as part of you getting your Medicaid benefits, we want to see you doing some job training. So I think we need to think about this more holistically about, you know, if we're going to get to the end result, we've got to figure out along the way what does a person need and what do they need to be doing as an individual? Where's their personal responsibility around this, and how can we incentivize that personal responsibility component to get to that end result?
Uh-huh. So speaking of incentivizing it, Steve called it behavioral economics, or I called it microeconomics before. Can we translate, can we sort of capture, codify, and translate those insights more broadly into states? We're getting little bits of insight about how you incentivize the different stakeholders. You know, VBID, the V and VBID, the value accrues differently to mm-hmm. the different stakeholders, right? This seems like a really difficult problem, but it also seems as though there's enough experimentation going on that there's some places we can try it out in the field, right?
Yeah, and I think one of the things for states, they're very, very limited by federal policy. And, you know, you can come up with lots of ideas, and as a consultant, you know, we can come up with lots of different things. But at the end of the day, you have to go to the federal government, and you have to ask permission. And the rules are extremely rigid. I mean, if you look at, and I'll just take the example of cost sharing, for example. I mean, basically, for CMS, if you want to charge somebody below 100% of poverty, they really, you know, you can't do premiums, you can only do copays, and then there's a specific amount of what those copays can be. I mean, that is a one-size-fits-all approach, and, you know, things that we talk about, whether it's premiums or required contributions or incentives, I mean, there's so, I think the possibilities are endless, but the limitation is really the federal policy, and I think we've got to really think about, you know, in terms of our ability or state's ability to move forward and do, and you heard Tony reference that as well.
Yeah.
You know, you keep your head down, but at some point, to do the really big changes that you want to do, you're going to need to have support from the federal government, and that is a key limitation.
Got it. So again, this is, I'm just sort of thinking, if I'm the graduate students who are taking notes on this, this business about how the evolution of Medicaid at the state level, and even some stuff we're seeing at the county level, is telling us that perhaps the nearly 50-year-old restrictions on Medicaid may be the things that might be holding us back a little bit instead of helping us in some instances.
Well, especially the Medicaid program was designed 50 years ago. It was for a very different population. It was for the disabled. It was for, you know, it's grown to take care of kids. It's, it's, you know, pregnant women. Now we're talking about covering, as we think about the expansion populations, you're talking about an adult population at higher levels of income.
Population.
So, but the rules haven't changed. The rules are the same ones that we had 50 years ago.
So a disconnect then, a bad fit, right?
I think so.
Great. Nick?
Here's an example of why it is antiquated. So we have 25,000 lives in one of our programs for frail elderly. It's our in-home support services program. It's a prevention program and getting people into SNFs, skilled nursing facilities, which costs a lot more money. So we're keeping them in their home with in-home provided services, some of them needing you know, full-day services, some just hours during the week. And we had a segment of the population in our eastern part of our San Diego, where it does get hot, by the way. We do have some hot weather, and we'll reach the 90s and 100-degree weather. And this was an elderly lady who was on Medicare, Medicaid, and limited budget, obviously, at that level, keeping her, though, still in her home. We were seeing a pattern of hospital admissions because of heat stroke. Do you know why? She didn't have an air conditioner. We wanted to buy an air conditioner. The cost was going to be about $350. And then with the cost of electricity, it was a drop in the bucket of what she was spending. Denied. She went to a skilled nursing facility, and we're paying now at least 10 times more. That's a classical example. My good friend, Dr. Bruce Goldstein at Oregon, and what they're doing with the coordinated care organizations. I mean, exactly. They're trying to get that type of flexibility to do much of what we're talking about. So I think we do have a state that is leading the way on that and those kind of modeling.
Right.
But it is a struggle with CMS. I agree wholeheartedly. And yet, the evidence there was right before our eyes, and it was not supported.
So what we're knowing about determinants in health is sort of exceeding or breaking the limits and contradictory to the way these programs have been set up. The programs, in some ways, don't allow accounting for these broader determinants of health. Big shortcoming.
If people have a question from the floor, please get the attention of someone with a microphone. We'll be with you in a second. Here's one right here. Before we do that, Steve, Michigan is such an interesting place. And I was just thinking, in the state of Michigan, you have the history of one of the brand industries in America, the auto industry, which is going through some great big changes. It involves a lot of people who have done better and sometimes worse. You've got a fairly large city that has defaulted now and that has lost, what, 40 or more percent of its population? I don't know what the number is.
Huge number.
So I think you have a hard job in sort of figuring out what's, not so much what's going on now, but how the sort of the epidemiology and the population dynamics are going to change the face of the state. Are you kind of worried about that at this point insofar as keeping them all in this system?
Well, I...
If you're trying to accomplish this, you have a heck of a moving target.
Well, I mean, I'm not sure that my purview is all of this. I think it's, you know, a broader set of folks in state government. And there are enormous challenges. And the governor, I think, is really focused on and very interested in the success of Detroit, which is, you know, a huge challenge. But I think, you know, as I think about this, and I'm a little bit of a contrarian on this, because while I recognize that there are all these social determinants of health, and we need to be able to buy air conditioners, and actually we figured out some ways to buy air conditioners with waiver programs and other things, and there's a lot of effort involved in getting the feds to agree to some waiver that you can do that. I mean, the reality is that, I mean, this is sort of like public health prevention. Not every public health prevention measure saves money. Mm-hmm. It may improve life and quality of life, but typically there's a cost with it. And some of these measures will offset certain expenditures that you wouldn't want to incur anyway. But they don't necessarily pay for themselves in every case, and maybe even in most cases. And I think the challenge here with getting into all these other social services is there's a lot of the population that the government isn't really set up for and hasn't endorsed financing these services for everybody. So it's a, you know, these are limited services in lots of ways in terms of resources. And so you know that there's some benefit from providing them, especially for the populations where you see the exacerbations and the cost. The question is, how do you target it in a way that is going to pay off? It really has to do with targeting populations, triaging, and trying to figure out, and the dual eligibles is a classic example, and you know, nobody was thinking that people would be eligible for both programs, otherwise they never would have designed it, because Medicare and Medicaid together in their traditional forms are totally dysfunctional. I mean, the incentives are in the wrong spot, it's a disaster. And these, you know, in Michigan, we're doing a dual eligibles demonstration, we're one of the 15 states that got grant funding to move forward and working through the process with the federal government, which hasn't been easy. And I sort of both feel for the feds in some ways, and being a bureaucrat, you know, you have that link, but at the same time, pretty frustrated at times as well. But, I mean, the reality is in Michigan, between Medicare and Medicaid, for the 200,000-plus duals in the state, we spend $8 billion on them. I mean, it is a staggering sum of money, and it can be spent better, and there can be better outcomes, and that's what we're trying to get our arms around. So, anyway, that's a sort of a meandering answer to your question, but
the $8 billion is going to not get any smaller, right?
Right, and if we can put it in a managed care framework, I think that there is the flexibility to buy air conditioners. You know, HMOs have some latitude in terms of what they do and what kind of interventions, and they can stray into what arguably are social services as opposed to, you know, within a medical care umbrella. You get some of that flexibility, but this is a hard... You know, this is a hard barrier or, you know, boundary to, you know, to work around. I mean, and work through. I mean, it's there are issues in terms of just saying, well, we're going to do all this stuff for people and that'll solve all the problems. It's not that simple.
Well, Nick thinks he can, so.
No,
From the...
I'm sure Nick has a...
from the great state of Wyoming. Yeah. And please hold the microphone a bit close.
Charles Scott, Wyoming Senate. Quick comment on the air conditioner example. We've found in Wyoming, CMS is just impossible to work with, and a very small state funds only program can pay big dividends on just that kind of thing. My question relates to the experience with Indiana and to a lesser extent to how Michigan is thinking of things with the HSA. The point in using an HSA is to give individual patients financial incentive to not use expensive services that they can avoid. And to do that, you've got to get them to look at the money in the HSA account as their own money and treat it as if it was their own. Both of you have obviously got the skin in the game argument of having some premium that goes to it. What other features does one of these HSA lookalikes need so that people will, in fact, treat it that way and have the incentive to conserve the money that's in the program?
Thanks.
We've got some, I would say, softer pieces to this, but I think they are vital. I mean, people get a monthly statement so that they can see what's being spent out of their account. We also have a website where they can go and look at the prices. Now, that's the part where it's a little difficult with Medicaid, is that you've got a Medicaid rate, so there's really not a whole lot of variation between providers. Now, there would be variation in terms of a setting, primary care versus the ER doctor, so there's a little bit of that. But I think those are some areas where we need to be able to go so that they are able to make those cost and quality decisions. I think there's also a link to price transparency with this as well. I think it was our hope in the state of Indiana that if there were more consumer-directed programs, that it would push the market towards going, to having price transparency, so that would be something that the consumers would demand of their providers. And I think that's the other piece that needs to happen to really have that consumer component, is the price transparency. I think that's missing in this.
Good point. Who here? Yes. Row 4, seat 5.
Roy Ramford, West Health. You ask providers to provide a medical home. I mean, they probably were fairly comfortable with this side. This side, that's uncharted territory.
It is,
so,
pretty much.
I mean, I don't know if you call that an economic home or what you call it, but I can't imagine providers trying to sign up for doing all of this stuff and their ability, their experience to even venture into some of those areas has got to create challenges within Medicaid to be able to actually pull this off. I mean,
Nick started this. Now, Nick, let me just pose this to you, Nick. And that is a very good question, but even the concept of ACOs not long ago may have been sound a little bit close to impossible. Nick, if you can prove to somebody that the transportation thing makes a difference in health outcomes, if you can prove to somebody that feeding them or providing them a way to get food makes an improvement in health outcomes, might there not be some cost savings to be realized by some kind of ACO squared or something like that?
I like that. We're calling it creating an accountable care community, not an accountable care organization. But it is a tall order. And I think this is where local government, county government, has to work in concert with its state partners, in that we're at the service delivery level, right? So we have convened with our Medicaid managed care plans and brought together a lot of these essential, by the way, state-funded social services. We're not about spending more money, initially. We're using more of the IHI principles of optimizing what we have to improve outcomes. So it was more about aligning the forces. It was more about making sure that a adult daycare center that didn't ever met the hospital discharge planners got to know each other. It was more about working with our medical transportation to turn it into paramedicine and piloting that, making it more than just pick up a transport, but being able to treat people and release. So we were looking at where do we add the value with these, and you're absolutely right. It is uncharted waters, but remember, in any local jurisdiction, there is a governmental entity that's beholden to its state partner or states that may be running it, if it's smaller states, that do live in that space of human services. I've said, Medicaid directors are your friend. I mean, I've had to broker and realize that they are friends. Because in the past, though, Medicaid directors, frankly, would not, you're the exclusion, would not invite the human services folks and vice versa. So we're looking first and foremost is aligning what we have to improve, kind of like we did with the care coordination. There are areas that we are looking to spend and invest in, where it's kind of Charlie's point about where CMS is giving us much grief. We're going to invest in because we do see it as taxpayer savings to us.
So to take your point just a bit further, and I think we all recognize how tough this problem is, but listen, we already heard about some places you can get the air conditioner, right? So to me, like, that's housing. And then there are other programs where folks can come into houses, homes where there are children who are living in damp, moldy environs, and you got to rip out the floor, repaint the wall, whatever it is, to kind of, that can have a big health impact on their asthma, right, and the other things that go with it. So we have seen some instances of it. We are a heck of a long way to go before we really cross the Rubicon here for everybody, but there are some models for trying to do that. And there's a silo, man's right, there's a silo attached to everyone. Question along the walls, yes.
Mark Fendrick, Leibitz Center. So Nick inspired me when I met him a year ago when he told me about the patient who was readmitted to the hospital, didn't take her medicines because it said on her medication bottle, you had to take the medications with food, and she had no food.
Right.
And this is what I had to take a broader view.
Oh my.
Since then, I've actually seen that the evidence shows that pet care improves outcomes and quality of life, such as the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center is buying puppies for high-risk kids. We know evidence of being married actually leads to better outcomes than not. I'm not sure if you're sending people to do that in Southern California,
not yet.
Nick. But
we're waiting for Oregon to do that.
No, I'm waiting
for... There are great opportunities now.
I was just going to say, for Joan, we'll put that on her list, because marrying the monkeys is one of my favorites. But Cliff and many people in the room know, I'm really good at spending other people's money and not good at spending any of my own. And Seema, I think you knew this question was coming. In the situation where people are banking these funds, and I agree completely with Senator Scott that we want people to not spend their money on the things they shouldn't buy. Mm-hmm. My concern since the first day I heard of what was called a consumer-directed high-deductible health plan mm-hmm. was that cheap people like me mm-hmm. would not buy the stuff they should buy. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, we've asked around the country, and Paul Fronson will speak about this a little bit later, but your experience in terms of what you think you're seeing in terms of cheap folks not going, not to not buy the MRI they don't need, but to not buy the immunizations and the colon cancer screenings and the drugs to treat their diabetes.
Well, I think a couple things. I mean, we recognize the preventative services, that would have been an issue. So that's not a part of the power account or the HSA account. So that's outside of it. I can tell you that for the most part, even, you know, $1,100 of a deductible is not really that much. The state's pretty much funding the most of it anyway. What we find is at the end of the year, about 30% have a balance in their account. So obviously people are spending. We have not seen any evidence of people not getting needed care, and we've looked at all of that data. So we're not seeing that. But what we do see is even though 30% only have a balance in their account, as I said earlier, if there's a balance in their account, then that money rolls over, it reduces what they owe. But, you know, obviously 70% of people don't have anything to roll over, but we see 84-85% of people getting their preventative care. So sometimes even just having the incentive there, I think, encourages the right behavior. But we've looked at, you know, is this a disincentive to get needed care? We're not, you know, we're not seeing that.
Point we'll make. Question here, please. Thank you. And by the way, the session's being recorded, which is why we do have to use mics and why we want to make sure we hear you. And I'm told that you have to put the mic really close to your, at least your chin.
Hi, Melissa Moorhead with Michigan Public Health Institute. And I'm interested in Indiana's experience being able to have a control population. Mm-hmm. I wonder if you were able to provide that population with the same kind of transparency and information about the cost of their services, even if they didn't have skin in the game.
They did. They, you know, everybody has access to the same information online through their health plan. So if they had access to that, you know, it's not, you know, clear with a low-income population how many of them actually use this. We did, in terms of our website use, that was very high. So we know that individuals are using it. How that related to the lowest of income or the people that didn't have income, that's not clear. But they had all the same benefits available. They just weren't making a contribution.
Okay. Hey, Aaron McKeithen, look up for a second. Hand that fellow a microphone. Got a question for him. He didn't know that yet.
I have a question for you.
Oh, you do. Okay. For our group?
Oh, I don't know.
We have a question. Okay, so here, no, honestly, here's the question. I happen to know that you're in the medication adherence business. So tell us, and we haven't talked about this before, is there anything up here that you know or you've learned is
a determinant of better adherence, including stuff to the right of the line?
Yes.
And what would that be?
We haven't looked at companionship and intellectual stimulation and everything on that depicted there, but I think clearly the cost of drugs is an important factor. We've seen in a NC free trial that Mark and others have participated in that lowering the cost of common chronic disease medications does make a difference in utilization, but it doesn't on its own drive massive increases in adherence. If you talk to patients who are not adherent, they typically to their medication, to chronic disease medications, there's typically several kinds of things: either values about the treatment, lack of clarity about why they're taking the medicine, difficulty with administration, too many meds to figure out how to take. But a big one is social support. If you look at a predictor like, does this patient live alone? Does this patient have a caregiver, particularly an elderly, Medicare patient that has trouble administering all these medicines? They can make a really big difference in predicting whether a patient will be adherent to their meds.
Okay. So who is here from the pharmaceutical industry? Good gosh. Okay. Would you hand this woman a microphone? So, Catherine, would you give your name and your company, and are you hearing anything about adherence or any of these other factors that might make people more willing or able to take those wonderful medications that you make, when and how they should?
Yeah, talk about an alignment of interest. Yes. Obviously, we'd have that too. Catherine Peach from Johnson & Johnson. So this is kind of like the Holy Grail. You know, people have been trying to crack this nut for a long time. And obviously our industry is very interested in that as well. And it is multifactorial. It's not just cost. It is about understanding the disease, about seeing value, about being properly motivated, about having the support where it's necessary. And we explore all these things, but I think we still haven't found that magic bullet yet to actually turn the dial on this, and especially for the chronic and complex patient. Uh-huh. Other than having somebody, actually support, high social support.
So you're saying it's a tough nut to crack. Do you have any role to take as a major life sciences company in promoting that?
Yeah, certainly. We're undertaking research programs along these lines in terms of trying to figure out which elements can actually, or which combination of elements can actually be better drivers.
Got it. Mm-hmm. So would you hand the microphone to the gentleman from Merck who sat next to me on the bus this morning? There's a mic over there. And Mr. Gray, you'll introduce yourself, and maybe you could tell us a little bit about how some of these factors influence the uptake of, let's say, that great HPV vaccine that you came out with not long ago.
So my name is Sam Jones. I'm with Merck. Happy to be here. And this is my second time visiting this conference. And so I would say if you think about things like vaccines, particularly for adults, having preventive services covered in the benefit design, having them covered first dollar, is a good start to make sure that patients who need access to vaccines can get them. You do also have other challenges with vaccines, particularly for adults, because we have them adjudicated in a number of ways. So if you're a senior and you need a shingles vaccine and you're in Medicare, it's in the Part D benefit. The drug benefit is adjudicated in the retail pharmacy. If you're under 65 and you need that vaccine, it's in your medical benefit, probably through your provider. And so through your employer carrier program, and so it complicates the places where the vaccines could be administered. So there's more than just the, is it in the preventive services? It's also very important to understand where patients originate, how often they originate, where they're visible to healthcare practitioners, and then it's also important the kind of messages they get from not just physicians, but also nurse practitioners, pharmacists, others who can help reinforce the need to get appropriate vaccinations.
And certainly some of the vaccinations, this is no advertisement for anyone in particular, some of these vaccinations, for example, let's say pneumococcal vaccination, have very large impacts
on health outcomes for a lot of these, actually for a lot of the dual eligible,
particularly for patients,
right?
With chronic conditions like diabetes or respiratory conditions, absolutely.
So you need to be in more than just the sell the vaccines business. You need to be in overall health management in the way we've been discussing this.
We would agree with our colleague from J&J and other colleagues from the industry. We think we do have a role to play, and we also invest heavily in research to try to find new ways to improve medication adherence, and we think it's a part of our commitment to a patient who ends up on our product. We need to help them find a way to stay on it until they reach a desired health outcome.
Great.
That's good for them.
Excellent.
Absolutely.
Far corner, please. Your name and affiliation. We'll have a quick question and response here.
Mark Staybuck with Alkermes. I'll ask you to look at that and consider a different type of patient, and one that we're involved in. Think about somebody with an opioid addiction. So you want to talk about a compliance issue, right? So when the person's addicted, their compliance is very high. You try to get somebody in a treatment program to break the addiction, you've got motivational issues, you've got family caregiver issues, and I'll say the biggest barrier around the benefits is the silos that you talked about. So I'll go so far as to say that I've had deep conversations with three health plans this year to say, look, if somebody has a heart attack and progresses through an interventional cardiology, a step-down care for rehab, there's protocols, there's rehab. We know how to do that. Mark will tell you all the things you got to do for that patient to get cost-effective value. If you deal with something like addiction, if the person can't get detoxed, they can't start therapy. If the therapy is only available through buy and bill and the physician doesn't do that, or the hospital or the specialty pharmacy can't deliver it in time, it won't get to the patient. So the patient will cycle in and out of rehab, detox, acute hospitalization, prisons. Some of the most innovative work from a disease management standpoint is now prisons who are dealing with it because the healthcare system won't accommodate. What I'll say to my colleagues in the health plans is, despite our willingness to say, look, we can't do this on our own, we'll help you, we will help fund it, we will go at risk with you, we'll figure out what's the best model, and we'll cost share however you want to do it, they all say, oh, it's really interesting, but I'm so overwhelmed with, I got to implement ACA, the ACOs are driving me crazy, I have regulatory barriers. So unless it's already on my agenda of something that was put in my objectives 3 years ago by my boss, we can't accommodate thinking anything new. So I think, like Sam and my colleague from J&J, I think we would be happy to collaborate with people who are looking for better ways to incorporate the drug into the care as opposed to just pushing the drug. But it has to be a collaborative effort, and I think the silos is the big barrier for all of us.
Got it. Point well made. Thank you. Closing question here, and we'll start with Seema here and work our way down. So no particular warning, Seema. So based on what you've heard thus far today in this panel in particular, how might you see some adaptation or application of VBID for helping to solve the kinds of problems that you presented in your case in Indiana? What's sort of the next way that you might use or apply or adapt VBID to solve at least some of that?
Yeah, I think we need to really think about what those incentives are. I think that that's a place to start. I think we've got to have greater use of that in the HIP program, where we have those incentives up front, and we don't have, you know, once you get into the program and once you make that initial contribution, I think there's got to be ways of feeling that, you know, throughout, not just I paid it, I'm using my account. The other thing is, once people finish that deductible, that $1,100 deductible, then they don't have any cost sharing. I think there are still some opportunities there. And I think, you know, if it's co-pays, we need to figure out how to crack that nut, because the co-pays, I think, you know, in a commercial population, that works really well. You can change the co-pays depending on what type of behavior. But in the low-income population, it's trickier because those aren't always collected by providers. So I think the challenge is trying to figure out how do we work with providers to get them to collect it. How do we address that? So I think that's one particular area. And then I think looking at, we're looking at, you know, the HIP program has been more of an adult population. I think we need to look at this, not in terms of families, looking at it more holistically and looking at it across not just one segment of the Medicaid program, but looking at it in terms of, you know, the pregnant moms, the kids, and how can we do this in a way to really expand it beyond just the adult population.
Great. Good. Excellent. Thank you. So, Steve, next application of VBID for the problems coming over the horizon?
Well, the simple and direct answer is we will be looking at altering our copay structure for, you know, high and low value services for the healthy Michigan population. And so we look to have, you know, 300 and some thousand maybe in the near term, up to almost 500,000 once the program matures. And we'll be looking to, you know, on the drug side to eliminate co-pays for certain high-value drugs and to maybe increase them as much as we can under federal rule for some of what we think the low-value services are. But, you know, we have the opportunity to do that, and I think that's a very direct application of VBID in the Medicaid program here in Michigan.
Great. Thanks, Steve. Excellent. Nick, next application of VBID.
It actually has probably nothing to do with the accountable care community we're talking about. It is actually more about the conversation earlier this morning about governance. And for us, it's San Diego County is the fourth largest employer in the region. We're trying to show the policymakers that we need to do VBID for ourselves. Because once they understand how it embraces them, as policymakers, we will transcend then more further into the dual eligible in our Medicaid population. So we're as much more thrusting from within to get to the true aim of more broadly the community.
Excellent. Thank you. Nick Machione, Steve Fitton, Seema Verma, excellent. Please join me in thanking this great panel.